Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the threshold shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods I will sing your praise. I will bow down toward your holy temple and praise your name. Because of your love and faithfulness, the kings of the earth will praise you, O Lord, when they have heard the words of your mouth. They will sing of the ways of the Lord, that that great is the glory of the Lord.
A reading from St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke. Once while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowd from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you,
Lord Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. One of my favorite children's poets is Shel Silverstein. Although I find that his cynical wit and his imaginative situations are really every bit as attractive to adults as they are to children. In fact, they might be understood better by adults. But anyway, and one of my favorite poems of his is a poem about a little girl named Abigail, who, when out driving with her parents, spies a sign that reads, "Pony for sale, cheap." She wants that pony more than anything and begs her parents to buy it for her. But of course, they say no, and instead they tell her that she can have a butter pecan ice cream cone. Abigail whines that she doesn't want ice cream, that she wants the pony, and if she doesn't get it, she'll die. Ridiculous, say her parents. Nobody ever died from not getting a pony. So Abigail goes home, and she doesn't eat, and she doesn't sleep, and she dies. And the poem ends with this advice to children. This is a good story to read to your folks when they won't buy you something you want. Well, that's kind of the long way around to introduce to you another of Silverstein's poems, which I really thought went with today's lessons. The poem that I have in mind is a little poem called What If? And it, as I said, is a very good beginning for all three of the lessons that we have this week. Because, well, I'll tell you in a minute why. Here's a little excerpt from that poem. Last night, while I lay thinking here, some what ifs crawled inside my ear and pranced and partied all night long and sang their old what if song. What if I'm dumb in school? What if they've closed the swimming pool? What if I flunk that test? What if green hair grows on my chest? What if nobody likes me? What if a bolt of lightning strikes me? I think what if questions abound when we are called to do something that is unexpected or something that we feel that we're really not prepared to do, especially when that call seems to be coming from God. It's then that a lot of the what ifs start to abound. Things like, well, I heard a call, but what if it really wasn't God calling me and just my ego? Or what if I can't see myself as a good enough person to be doing God's work? Or what if the call expects me to give more than I feel I really want to give? Or what if I later find out that I'm terrible at what I agreed to do? You know, when I was considering the priesthood, I had a lot of what if questions, you know, like, what if I'm not really worthy to be a priest? Of course, I learned later on, nobody's worthy in and of themselves. Or what if I'm not smart enough to do the coursework? Or what if the Commission on Ministry rejects me? Or what if in the interviews that I have to make, I appear stupid or vague? What if I'm really not good at this? And on and on. Now, you might be thinking, what do all these what ifs have to do with the lessons that we have for today, especially the gospel, which talks about the calling of the first disciples as Luke sees it? Well, be patient. We'll get to that in a moment. And everything will be clear. Well, maybe. But first, a little response to those what ifs. The problem with what ifs is that they are usually prompted by fear. Fear of something that may or may not happen, you know, like the fear of rejection or the fear that you're going to let someone down. We all have these kind of fears. Children do as well. And I think that they sometimes believe what that poem says, that they might be dumb in school or flunk a test or be not unliked or even grow green hair on their chest and be struck by lightning. Adults are not free from fears either. Fear that sometimes are so great that they paralyze our ability to do anything. Things like fear of changing a job or moving to a new place or being alone. So I want us to think about the real fears that we might have when we hear God's call to us. And I want us also to think that what makes all of those what ifs that we might have in answer to that call are really irrelevant and at least unfounded. For instance, let's say you do hear the call of God sometime or another and you want to answer it. But you wonder if you're really good enough person to be able to live up to the expectations that you think God has for you. Well, if you want examples of those who did not live up to what God might expect, we have only to look at the three characters we have today, Peter and Paul and Isaiah. In the boat, we hear Simon Peter say to Jesus, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." And you'll recall that later in his travels with Jesus, he rebukes Jesus for predicting his suffering and death. And later on, he even denies knowing Jesus after Jesus has been arrested, something that he swore he would never do. And what about Paul, who persecuted the followers of Jesus, dragging them back to Jerusalem for punishment, forcing them to blaspheme, even encouraging the death penalty for them, all in the name of religious orthodoxy? He writes in the letter from Corinthians that we have today, "For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God." Isaiah, after his vision of God, declares, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips." And still, God used them in spite of themselves, because they did answer the call. The truth of all this is that human failure, human sin, human inadequacy are not obstacles when God calls you. God has never gotten or required a perfect messenger, only a faithful one. We all know that in our broken state, we could never be the perfect messenger that we think God might want, no matter how earnestly we wanted to be or how good we try to be. And yet, God will choose us because we're all he has to do his work. And so, I guess we can just do our best and depend on God's love and mercy and guidance to do the rest. So let's look at the gospel for a moment. Now, Jesus is beside the Lake of Gennesaret, which is another name for the Sea of Galilee. And there's a large crowd gathered to hear him, as usual. In fact, it's so large a crowd, it's almost pushed him into the lake. And so he gets into a little boat that Simon owns and is rowed out away from the shore and sits down to teach the people. Now, Jesus isn't doing anything unusual here. He's been doing what he's been doing all along since that expulsion from the synagogue in Nazareth that we heard about a few weeks ago. He's been wandering around the place, healing the sick, casting out demons, teaching about life and the kingdom of God. And now he sees this eager crowd again gathered to hear his teaching. And maybe this time he realizes that he's going to need some help in doing this. He needs some help in carrying on the work that will need to be done once he is gone. And so he calls the first of his disciples in a rather unique way. After he finishes his teaching, he tells Simon to row out into deep waters and to cast his net into the lake for a catch of fish. And Simon says that, well, they've done this already, and they didn't catch anything. Maybe he's wondering, well, what if I let down the nets again and still catch nothing? But nevertheless, he does it. And lo and behold, the catch that he gets is enormous. It is so enormous that he has to call for help. And his partners, James and John and others, come to help him. Now, this, of course, would be a great thing for a fisherman because it means prosperity. But I don't think Jesus was really interested in catching fish, but he is interested in catching them. And catch them he does. He calls them away from their daily life. He says to them, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." In the other synoptics, it says, "You will fish for people." And they get up, they leave their work, they leave their families, they leave their homes, and they follow Jesus. There are three things to note here. First of all, they're not going off to some philosophical school to be taught by some great teacher. No, they're going to walk with a man who is teaching and preaching and healing and casting out demons and all that. And they're going to be working side by side with Jesus, learning as they go. Secondly, their call wasn't initiated by themselves. It was initiated by Jesus. They didn't just decide, this is a great teacher, I think I'll go and follow him. They were invited to come and follow him. And third, these men were really not called to change their state of being. They were fishermen, and they would continue to be fishermen. But now their catch would be a little different. You know, our call to follow Jesus is not so different from these three. Of course, it will maybe be an inner call instead of a physical one, but it could be someone calling you to do something for God. But nevertheless, it will be a definite call. We are called to work side by side with Jesus and with God and do whatever it is that God has prepared us already to do. Remember that list that Paul gives us? We could be teachers, we could be preachers, or healers, or comforters, or listeners, or feeders, or whatever. They are all ways in which we can teach the kingdom and to show what life in the kingdom of God is like. Finally, the effect of this call is that we are both called from something and to something. What are we called from? Well, these early disciples, they were called from everything they knew. They were called away from their homes and their families and their livelihoods to follow Jesus. But do you think that's what Jesus wants or God wants from you if you're called? Well, maybe, but I don't really think so. But I do think he is calling you away from lives that are riddled with pettiness and division, with factionalism of the kind that threatens our community, with narrow-mindedness, with mean-spirited competition. And thinking about all of those things, it really would be easier to leave fishing nets than it is to leave the nets of our own prejudices. And what are we called to? Well, it's very simple. We are just called to carry on the same ministries in whatever ways we can that Jesus and his followers have always exampled for us. Ways to love God and ways to love our neighbors. I expect you all know the old hymn, Jesus calls us o'er the tumult of our life's wild, restless sea. Day by day, his clear voice soundeth, saying, Christian, follow me. Well, when and if you hear the voice of God calling you and saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? I hope you won't listen to those pesky what ifs prancing and partying in your head, but instead be eager to answer with the prophet, here am I, send me. Amen.
join in the prayer of the people? Let us pray.
Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need, saying, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For the church, for Michael, our presiding bishop, Mike, our bishop, Michael, our bishop, cardinal elect, for Josh and Richard, our priests, and for the ministries of healing and wholeness, for hospital and hospice chaplains, for all who proclaim freedom and release in the name of Christ. Let us pray. For the nations, for all who lead in cities and towns, states and countries, especially Joseph, our president, and Jim, our governor, and for community organizers, school officials, and health organizations that may always strive to serve those in need. Let us pray. For all wearied by life's burdens, for those who are poor, for those lacking supportive relationships, for those crushed by debt, for those exhausted from work and or stress, for those struggling with chronic pain and other sickness, remembering especially Shirley Milton, Shirley Bailey, Stephen Spurlock, Mick Sinclair, Barbara Estep, Aaron Naughton, Linda Troeger, Karen Gross, Pat Garrett, Allison Halford McLeod, Nancy Hubbard, Patty Niggemeyer, Kathy Torbett, Flora Garcia, Minty Ross, Claire Thayer, John Madden, and Colin Madden, and for all those who cry to you for help, let us pray. For this congregation, for our outreach ministries and their volunteers, for our nurturing and fellowship ministries, for the young people in this place who open us to new understandings, for those among us celebrating birthdays or anniversaries, remembering Kylan Sheets and Michael and Amy Hicks. Let us pray. In thanksgiving for the faithful departed, remembering Mr. and Mrs. Cecil Connor, and whose memory the flowers are given, and for Peter Freeman, who were called by name and now rest from their labors, that their lives serve as witnesses to the goodness of God. Let us pray.
By what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us. You may delight in your will and walk in your ways for the glory of your name.
Thank you.
Good morning. There we go. I'll get used to this one day. Just a couple of announcements to pass along. The annual report, if you are haven't been here for a couple of weeks, the annual report is in the back for you to take a look at. And our election results, Charles Bursey, Mary Hanley, and Peter Staffel, 3-year terms, with Dory Jacob in a 2-year term. And then our convention delegates, Mary Ruth Sillis, Linda Cummins, and Mark Harshman, and then Becky Sinclair as an alternate. There are a couple of other announcements in there. Take a look at them as you're able. I do want to make a note for the food pantry. Volunteers are always needed for that. And if that's something that you can assist with, then please do let us know in the office, and the contact information is in your bulletins. The Saxes did move in, and so we are in the neighborhood, the Woodsdale neighborhood. And we, you know, great week to do some moving in. So I've got some stories already. Maybe one day they'll make it into a homily or a sermon. But we're moved in, and you know, only depending on the room, about knee deep in packing paper and boxes. So things are coming along. Are there any announcements for the good of the mission or ministry of St. Matthew's? Ascribe to the Lord the honor to his name, bring offerings, and come into his courts. Please stand. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." And therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son and his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, The gift of God for the people of God. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, And the peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you always. Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.